I will be talking about certain trends in technology and education. So I'm going to begin by talking about technology by itself and then move to discussing some of the implications. And I'm going to try to talk about things that my colleagues are not talking about. If we have any overlap, I'll point to them. So to begin with, let me just say greetings. I'm from the United States. If you couldn't tell, this is where I live. It's a little colder than Malta right now. We only have 2 feet of snow, so it's pretty mild for us. On a grimmer note, I have to say greetings from the United States. I try not to talk about this, if at all possible, but I will have to tomorrow. This doesn't impinge on technology too much, but if you have questions about Trump, the technology, and education, please, I'm glad to have them. What we'll be doing, what I'd like to do is focus on how we can best get at the future of education and technology. And one of the most powerful ways is by looking at present trends and extrapolating them into the future. So looking at what we can see in the present that will unfold or grow into future possibilities. So I'm going to outline those and then try to articulate some possible futures and choices based on them. I have two sources for this, two original points. One is the Horizon Project. How many of you know the Horizon Project? Well, good, 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 good. If you haven't seen it, whip out Google right now. It's a project from the New Media Consortium where they do a report using the Delphi method of working with a group of experts around the world to get at the future of a particular field. So this is a shot from the cover of their Higher Education Technology Report. They've also done reports for libraries, for certain countries like Brazil, for certain subsectors like research libraries and K-12. It's a very, very productive group. So I, just in full disclosure, I helped chair this a couple of years. This is part of the basis for what I'll be talking about. Another basis is a monthly report I publish called Future Trends in Technology and Education. I'm mentioning this here partly to explain what I'm doing and then partly to show you something nice. So every month this comes out and it scans the horizon for current events that play on the future of education and technology. About half of this report is footnotes. It's all meticulously sourced. It's very dry. It's written at a very basic level, like the university president level. And then it's been going on for some time, for 5 years now. So we can take a look at trends month by month, year by year, and map them into the future and see if these are strong trends or weak ones. And by trends, we cover a lot. You shouldn't be able to read this slide because it has too much on it. This is one part of the FTDE report. These are just leading trends in technology, something similar for education and technology. So it's pretty dense stuff. Today, I'm going to pull out some of the leading ones for you. But here's the part to show. I could simply do this report by sitting at a library and publishing it with a research team. But a key thing about this is that most of it gets worked through social media. So every story that I find, I push out immediately through Twitter, Google+, and LinkedIn to say, what do you think? Is this real? Is this legitimate? Will this have impact? And then people throw stories at me the same way. So using social media actually improves the report. It makes our intelligence greater. Do a lot of this through Twitter, a great deal through Twitter. All right, enough meta, into some trends. This is a photo that helps give you a sense of how rapidly technology advances. If you can't quite make this out, on the left, that chip has 128 meg. On the right, 128 gig in just 9 years. Which is kind of interesting to see. And what I'd like you to imagine is what that chip will look like in 2024. Will it actually be a chip? Will it be visible to the naked human eye? My point is technology is advancing very, very quickly. You all know that, but we need to keep that in mind when thinking about education. So if we step back and look at some of the major trend lines, some of the ones that are shaping us, let me give you a couple just so you know. This is a contradiction that happens. Quite a few technology companies really want us to live in vertical stacks. So Microsoft wants you to have your Xbox, your Windows machine. They want you to have your Windows phone. They want you to have Office. Apple wants you to have the iPhone, the iTunes, everything else in the eye. Amazon has its own desires. Windows has its own desires. Google has its own desires for vertical integration. Meanwhile, you actually don't necessarily do that. You have horizontal use. That is, you may have an Apple laptop, and you may have a Microsoft phone, and you may have an Amazon Kindle reader, and so on. So at the top level, this dynamic is very powerful and shapes a lot of tech support, a lot of our usage. Another major trend is we used to think we have privacy. Now we know better. Thanks to Snowden and other people, we now know that the amount of digital surveillance that exists is epic and extensive. In Europe, you actually take this seriously. In the United States, we don't think about it at all, which is a problem, which we will eventually get to, I think. But this shapes, again, so much of what we do with technology and education. How much privacy our students have, how much privacy our faculty have. Now let me give you some more trends about technology before we get to the classroom. This is one of the founders of Wired, Kevin Kelly, who's been analyzing trends in technology for some time. And recently, he articulated them in the form of 8 verbs of what technology is doing and how it's changing. It's a nice set. I wanted to pull out 4 of those in particular. One of the things that's happening with our use of technology is that we are increasingly accessing content rather than owning it. So let me see a quick show of hands. How many of you are on Spotify? Oh, good. How many of you use Rhapsody? Nobody does. Rhapsody. It's a nice tool. Nobody uses it. How many of you get music from YouTube? Yeah. So instead of owning a DVD or a CD-ROM or a vinyl disc or a cassette tape or an 8-track, instead of all of that, you access it. And you think Amazon with its Kindle ebook store has something very similar. They actually, you download the files, but they really can control it in many ways. We're happy with this. Generally speaking, consumers are moving in that direction. The second point is sharing, or what the legal profession refers to as rampant copyright violation. We absolutely love sharing content, and we do this in all kinds of ways. We get a story, we pass it on through Twitter, as I mentioned before. We pass it on through Facebook. We email it to a friend. We pin it in Pinterest. We love sharing stuff. That's just human nature, it seems. That's how we use the technology. An interesting problem with courseware is that a lot of it prohibits sharing. It's very hard to share through Moodle, for example. 2 more trends. Cognifying. We're increasingly adding some form of rudimentary intelligence to our tools. We're trying to make them smarter. So you already know that a Google search bar can anticipate your search, which is eerie and uncanny to think about, but it's actually pretty neat. Just as an experiment, if there's a term that you're interested in, type in the term into Google, then hit space and see what completion it suggests. You're gonna have a lot of fun with this. You're typing something like academia is. The terms aren't necessarily what you might like to see. They're more and more powerful tools, so you might wanna think about Duolingo, for example, a language learning app, which has a rudimentary form of artificial intelligence based in. We also filter. That is, when we pass things around and we share things, we act as a filter. So you think about a journalist who filters news for you, or a blogger, or a podcaster. And increasingly, to use the vast swarm of information, we turn to people who filter it for us. This is a new mix of technology use patterns. And again, this informs how we do technology and education. Automation continues to be growing in all kinds of ways. I mentioned it last night for those of you who were here. There are lots of jokes about this. You can ask Siri what she thinks about Skynet. This is a fun one. I'm looking for pictures of you, Siri. No offense, Bryan, but you couldn't handle my spatial resolution. There's a lot of humor to be had. Let me just ask you guys, which country came up with this? That's a chainsaw attached to a drone. Which country would you guess? No. It's not a country yet, but no. Not the US.
Finland.
How'd you know?
I don't know. It just, there's lots of woods and they're techie.
You got it.
And the sky is gray and gloomy.
Well, that could be anywhere in Scandinavia. But yes, this is a Finnish invention, attaching a drone to a chainsaw, just so you know it can be done. You can also attach a shotgun, but that's another issue. So automation is growing rapidly. We're entering science fiction territory. Here are a few ways of things that are happening. Robots have already changed industry. You all know this. We already have self-driving cars and self-driving trucks. We have robots being used at war and in police. So we have an ethical problem, which is what happens when a robot kills the wrong person? Who is responsible? That's a serious ethical problem that people are talking from the UN all the way down to military units. We have spam bots, who are probably the most prolific authors of content in human history. We have high-frequency trading. Have you followed this at all? This is in the stock market, where you have computer programs that trade stocks back and forth with each other. They operate almost beyond the human capacity to follow them. And they've already caused at least one stock market crash and power a great deal of trading houses. We also have automated writing tools. So we have programs that can write meteorology, sports, and financial news, which are actually pretty good at it. All of this is happening now. It's accelerating and going faster. We can actually use artificial intelligence to help us in our creativity. So, for example, this is a friend of mine in Mexico City, sitting down, trying not to notice me taking a picture of him. I took this photo and uploaded it to a Google tool called Deep Dream. Has anybody here used that? Deep Dream helps you reimagine your photo. So it turned it into a psychedelic work like this. Yeah, if you go to Deep Dream, you'll see many examples of this. I couldn't have done this myself. I'm not that talented. Actually, most people couldn't. And it's not the same. Every time it looks at it, it analyzes the photo and interprets it on its own, like a good artist would. Deep Dream is a free tool already. So we have technology helping us with our creativity. A few more trends, and then to the classroom. Mobile is obviously vital. And in fact, web design has just changed because now we design the web for mobile devices first. So if you're looking at a device on a laptop or a desktop, you're kind of a shrinking minority of the audience. This has changed our media consumption habits drastically. This is a quick chart showing where Americans consume which media. If you just work your way around this table, you can see live DVR, time-shifted TV, TV connected devices, PC video, smartphone video, tablet video, internet on a PC, social media on a smartphone, social media on a tablet. I mean, the media consumption galaxy has just expanded in all kinds of ways. And then we have new technologies. So a big question with virtual reality is, which way is it going to go? Is it going to become terrifying and dystopian looking like this? Is it going to become embarrassing? This is the worst picture in the history of humanity, apparently. This is the fellow who invented Oculus Rift, by the way. Or will it become boring? It's wonderful to see President Obama looking at this, but look at the woman on the left. Most powerful man in the world using VR, yeah, big deal. She doesn't care. So we should hope that it becomes this in many ways, that something becomes a product that we can use. But VR is in many ways already passing into history. We can now combine VR with augmented reality to yield some called mixed reality. So if you look at the physical world, to have virtual reality content superimposed or inserted onto it. This is one pedagogical use to think about. Imagine having virtual reality details and data superimposed on the world you look at. In this case, a storm. Several companies, including Microsoft, they've already had tools that let you play a game or look at a spreadsheet on a table right in front of you. You can manipulate it with your hands. The devices become more complicated, and we keep growing more and more devices. A key piece of this is that the ecosystem becomes more diverse. So we already have a big global battle between the Android and the iOS platforms. We have computing that's disintegrating. As instead of unifying into one device, we have more and more special purpose devices. And it's also shrinking. We now have wearable computers, very small cameras and computers. And one of my favorite examples is this. This is a small computer with a radio, a processor, and memory. It can record details. It is about the size of a grain of rice. It's 2 years old. It is literally a museum piece. So you want to think about the point where our technology becomes too small to see. Remember what I was saying about privacy? Cute idea, right? We can also network this stuff, hence the idea of the Internet of Things. So if you have little pieces of computing that you can put in your clothes, you can get feedback on your clothes when they're in the closet, you can network an egg carton, tires on a car, pieces of your house. We can basically turn the entire lived environment into one massive networked situation. The Internet of Things, or what some call the Internet of Everything, is just burbling along. And there's two possible horizons that are transformative up ahead that we have to look for, and they could change everything we do. One is the possibility that Moore's law will slow down or stop. You know, this is the law that says that CPU speed increases, memory gets cheaper, more capacious. We're already doing marvels of microelectronics to try and keep that going. That could stop. And if you think about the computation we have now, this is the end point. If things don't really change, then we have to think about where computing goes. There's also the possibility that we may stop growing the web, which sounds crazy until you realize we use a lot of technology that isn't on the web. So if you get a mobile app for your phone, that takes you off of the web. If you use a streaming service, that takes you off of the web. If you use texting or messaging, that takes you off of the web. we're starting to build more and more of our online life away from the great invention of British Sir Tim Berners-Lee. We're not sure when that would happen, but I'm watching hard for signs of those. Let's get into education. Here's one key sign of it. This is a makerspace with a 3D printer. And one of the wonderful things about 3D printers is they could wipe out the global economy. Have you all seen a 3D printer or used one? If you haven't, it's a great feeling of feeling science fiction become real. But one thing about them is you can print things that you normally had to buy or have shipped to you. You could print toys, you could print tools, you could print parts, clothing. So eventually you wonder what that happens to the trade around the world. Will international trade slow down as we have more and more printing? But this is a makerspace. It's a non-hierarchical, horizontally organized environment where people can play with physical technology using digital technology to help them. By the way, am I going too fast, too slow? This is okay. I'm a native New Yorker, so I talk quickly. I try to be slower. I don't have the accent. I can do it if you want, but I'd rather not. Also in the classroom, a few more trends to look at. Blended learning or flipped learning, or the hybrid classroom, which is really all part of the same thing, seems to be growing. That is, people are taking digital technology, including it in the classroom intentionally, as Alex said at the very beginning of today's session. We're also taking some classroom experiences and shifting it out of the classroom, most famously lectures. So we're taking them to audio or video so we can save more classroom space for more interaction, question and answer, role playing, and so on. Distance learning or online learning continues to grow. No one remarks on this anymore because it's so normal. But we're coming up to a point soon where the amount of people studying online is going to be roughly equal to the amount of people studying face to face. Well, that was supposed to happen in 2017, maybe it will. We're seeing generation gaps continue to widen. And I'm kind of obsessed with this, I mentioned it this morning. But basically, the older a person is, generally speaking, around the world, the less likely they are to use a lot of technology. Generally speaking, the younger you are, the more likely you are to use technology. There's whole gaps and problems in this, but the tendency holds true very much. For example, in the United States, the median age of a television news viewer is 69. So people who are under 30 don't watch TV news. They get it online. So we have this two parallel universes right now. Now, we also have the possibility of revolution in the learning management system world, or the virtual learning environment. Do you all say VLE in your different countries here? It's an awkward term, but it works either way. Actually, the Wikipedia page is virtual learning environment. So you guys have that measure of success in nomenclature. Right now, the VLE LMS market is pretty saturated, pretty mature, not a lot of developments happening, which is why a lot of us are thinking about what happens next. So beyond Blackboard, Moodle, Sakai, Canvas, what's the next LMS? And one possibility is that you could take the LMS, break it into pieces, and disintegrate it, move it around, so that people can operate outside of it and bring information back inside. So perhaps they're using social media, perhaps they're using video, including it inside. It's an interesting idea, very, very hard to do technically, very hard to do for some companies, but you want to watch for that. If you're interested in this, tonight at 8 p.m., I'm doing a video conference with the guy who invented the term, Next Generation Digital Learning Environment, and we'll see how that goes. Couple more trends. We mentioned OER already, so I don't need to talk about that. The maker movement, one of the interesting things with the maker movement is that in the United States it has government support. So the White House has had maker events. The governor of California has sponsored massive maker events. You see these in civic life as well. We hope to have a bring your own device policy across the US. We're not there yet. I would say maybe 5% of colleges and universities actually do that, actually let you bring your own device. They'd like to have that happen, but it's complex and scary. But mobile is still possible. We're also looking at virtual reality, augmented reality for education. The pedagogies for this are obvious for visualization and co-creation. Social media is something which academia desperately fears, but all of us use, which is an interesting problem, the dichotomy. Kind of schizophrenia, but we use social media in all kinds of ways. Students for Facebook for studying, faculty, blogging, the blogosphere and academia is now enormous. And we also use web video. The most popular social media platform for American academics is YouTube. and people use it in classroom all the time. Data analytics slowly beginning to rise. We're slowly beginning to build more and more of it. You heard Cable Green this morning urge that we use more of that in open education. And ebooks and e-textbooks have conquered the world of casual reading and stopped. They're not widespread in textbooks. They're not widespread as reference books yet. We're still thinking about that. Now, you're going to be talking about MOOCs, I hope. So I will just give you this weird picture, skip it. And I mentioned just a couple of themes that we're talking about. That some of them came up already. Jeff, I don't know if you're the one who mentioned this, but the two cultures divide, how we see more STEM use in MOOCs. Well, let me leave that to you guys. Research is changing under the impact of technology. That much we know. That much is a kind of cliche. Everything from where scholarly publication lives to the devices we use to conduct research. And we're seeing this occur in many, many different fields. One of them is simulations. So climate science as we know it now, half of it is based on simulations of what happens if we load more carbon into the atmosphere. We have a whole set of schools of thought, of branches of information based on high-powered computation. Computational genomics, life sciences, bioinformatics, computational molecular sciences. We have new media studies as a growing field. We have predictive policing. Have you talked about this much in European politics? So you build a database of what criminals do over time. Mm-hmm. And you can then use that to predict what might happen. So judges in the United States, if they're sentencing somebody, all right, you committed a murder, what should I sentence you to? They consult the database, and based on his experience, his background, his prior convictions, they have an estimate of how much time he should get. So they help the judge assign a sentence, which is very interesting. And now we teach that in higher education. I mentioned high frequency trading as well. We have digital documents, right? We produce more and more documents that are born digital. We scan more and more of them in. And as a result, we can do things with them that are powerful, from text mining to document discovery. This is already changing law, because a major function of lawyers is going through documents, pulling out data. It's easier and cheaper to have an AI do that for you. And then in my field, in the humanities, we now have the birth of what they call the digital humanities. I've seen digital technologies to pursue humanities questions. And this goes from creating digital archives to making new visualizations to text mapping and text analysis. In fact, it's possible that right now the community of scholars is more closely knit together by social media and email than it is by anything else, including publication. This is President Obama answering Ask Me Anything on Reddit. So his first post was, I'm the President of the United States, ask me anything. And people did. It's kind of cute. So, to think about, don't answer this right now because of time, but just to think about, I would ask, which of these trends seems the most powerful to you? And then, the trickier question is, which of these is the most unpredictable? Think about that later on. Maybe you have questions for me. Now, all of these are in the present. All of these are current trends that we know about. These are all documented, they're not speculative. We can talk about what comes next. Can I have 5 minutes to do that, or? Okay, be really quick. So what happens with all these trends if we push them into the future? Well, if we do a very, very simple extrapolation, campuses of tomorrow might look like this. We may have a rich multimedia environment. So right now, I'm using a projection, two-dimensional, using PowerPoint, a technology that was cutting edge in the 1980s, right? So imagine having VR, AR, and mixed reality being part of scholarly presentations and of the classroom, and of students expecting that. Imagine, too, gamification. So that is applying game principles to teaching and learning, or actually using computer games in the classroom. Imagine seeing that as more widespread. A good friend of mine teaches a class in Arab-Israeli politics, and he has the students play a game called Peacemaker. Very frustrating game. It's a simulation of Arab-Palestinian politics. Palestinian-Israeli politics. So as you imagine, it's very frustrating. So students read materials about it, and they play the game from one side, write a reflection of what they learned, read some more, then play the game from the other side. Imagine more and more games across the curriculum. Moreover, your students, think of them as producers. So 5, 10 years from now, a student will make PowerPoint presentations, posters, slides, videos, essays, the stuff will be digital and can be on the web. We have to think about that in terms of policy. What does it mean for an 18 or 22-year-old to be a copyright holder and in a class being taught by another copyright holder? We have to think about remix. We have to think about academic integrity as a result. We could also think about computing disintegrating even still further and thinking about it as a service. So to have a device, say a phone, which to which you can summon up your augmented reality layer or your LMS or a call with a friend, we have to think about how campus supports all of that. Meanwhile, you have to imagine a campus completely drenched with data, with people recording and sharing, and analyzing, surveying, and being very creative about data all over the map. When we think about a student who enters your campus for the first time, as they proceed through your campus, they are generating data like mad. How many times they check in the class site, how many comments they post, how often it takes them to finish a quiz. A good colleague of mine at the University of Michigan is a meteorologist. He now has data to prove that within 10 days of the first semester of his class, he can predict if a student will pass or fail his class with 90% accuracy within 10 days. Now, he's a wonderful man, a great teacher. So for him, this means he can direct more resources to the students who are going to fail, or politely say, maybe you should take the class or do something else. Imagine this 5 years from now. Imagine 10 years from now, when you have a 16-year-old and enough data analytics to predict accurately their university career. How does that change curriculum? How does that change your relationship with students? Meanwhile, the same campus, massively, massively networked. Set foot in campus, and you can summon up your office. A student has put in campus, they can find you in their office and send you a message right from there. Just the beginning.
But this is purple. Is that better? Do I have to use a lower voice? I could do a death metal voice. Taking automation seriously.
All right. We could, if we think about automation and applying it to education, this is a deep, deep issue with a lot of ramifications. For example, if we have widespread underemployment as a result of automation, what happens to curriculum? Are you supposed to design schools to prepare students for a life of leisure or for a life of rapidly switching jobs? Our schools don't do that right now. How do they look different in that case? Or if, on the other hand, we still have jobs, but they're all deeply integrated with AIs, how do we change our curriculum in political science, in mathematics, in biology? Moreover, and this is a deeper problem, slowly but surely, machines are getting better and better at human things. So beating humans at chess was a big deal. Beating us at Go was an even bigger deal. A Microsoft team last month has software that does speech transcription at our level right now. So if you give this program an audio file of me speaking, it can transcribe it as good as a professional transcriptionist. Give it a year, it'll be better. What happens to what it means to be human when our devices are better at being human than we are? We have to rethink a lot around that. Pedagogically, you have to wonder to what extent we can have an app instead of a class. I mentioned Duolingo. Have you all seen this program? One, two, Margaret? Yeah. Okay. If you haven't, it's a language teaching program. It was partially designed by the guy who invented CAPTCHAs. You know, the bottom of a page where it asks you to type in a number to prove you're not a robot, was this invention. And Duolingo is a very good, basic program for teaching you a foreign language. I'm learning Spanish in it right now. I tested it in Russian, which I actually know. It's very, very smart. It follows me. It tests me on things that I don't do well on. It reminds me of things. It cheers me up. It acts like a basic tutor. There's another body of computer programs that help you in your writing. I don't mean grammar and spelling. But they can scan your document for passive voice, active voice, vocabulary quality, mood, complexity of sentences, again, like a writing instructor could. So what happens if we can outsource teaching and learning to individual apps? Do we have classes based in computer-assisted creativity? So if you have an art studio class, do you have an AI there to help you paint? Does teaching become a cyborg form where we have to teach with a lot of technology involved? This is a different form of campus life. Or we think about digital literacy. Just so you know, Americans are now going crazy about digital literacy. We're really afraid of fake news, which is a little too late, but we're really afraid of this. So now we're discovering, oh, maybe we should look at things skeptically. It's a big deal. So what if we took digital literacy seriously? I mean, my argument, I co-authored a study on this, is that we should think about digital literacy as a maker literacy, where students don't just perceive, but they make stuff as a result. And then maybe they make things with video, with office productivity tools. I mentioned a few more, with cloud-based tools. Maybe digital literacy requires more advanced tools, like hardware, working with hardware, or maybe printing 3D, or coding. It's possible we'll see digital literacy embedded in different curricula. The hard part about this, it's kind of like democracy. If you give people these tools, they might not do what you want them to do. So if you teach students to be digitally literate, they don't necessarily become very obedient. They can criticize you. They can put their tools together and organize. So you have to wonder, ultimately, is digital literacy an insurgency? I think so. But a better form of digital literacy is storytelling, where you ask a student to combine the information they've been learning, restructure it, and represent it as a narrative. To do so is powerfully challenging cognitively. It's a wonderful way of building assessment in. It's a great way to be creative. It's a good way to give the students the ability to make stuff instead of just consuming it. And it gives them a voice. If you're looking at an 18-year-old, a 22-year-old who's wondering who they are and what they're going to be, having them make a story is a great way for them to start finding out. All right, last pedagogy and then I stop. I've been talking about institutions teaching classes, which is what we do. But what if you can put the institutions together and have them teach across boundaries? These are two projects that I've worked on. This is the Council of Independent Colleges, about 200 small colleges. They have a series of upper-level humanities seminars. So these are really, are you being fried by light here? Okay, sorry. So these are upper-level seminars like Byzantine art, history of the bookstore, topics in the American Civil War. And these are usually taught, and they usually get two or three students each. So instead, these classes are online within this group of schools. So a student at one, a faculty member at one class teaches it, and he has students sign on from 8, 10, 12, 20 classes throughout the consortium. And he now has 20 students. So he has a full class, a diverse class, a very powerful one, and all the other colleges get to expand their curriculum without having to offer it themselves. This group here, LACOL, is doing a math class in much the same way, working with advanced calculus, that is being taught across five or six campuses at the same time. So they're combining face-to-face with online learning. So think about this model across Europe. Imagine using, say, the Europeana resource as the anchor for a class on, say, World War I in Europe. Imagine having it be taught in Poland, France, Germany, Italy at the same time. What a wonderful model for expanding curriculum and really using digital technology. And this is what I'm going to leave you with. This is a group of 15-year-olds. Where I live, we are a very low technology state. About 60% of our state has cell phone coverage. It's not a high-tech place. This is a secondary school where the kids had an assignment. They had to go into their community, find a building that was historical. They could pick what historical meant. Then they had to research it. So they had to figure out what the building was, who built it, look at floor plans, look at blueprints. Then they had to build it in 3D printing. So they had to model it, learn the software, and then print this out. And then they had a big contest where they compared their buildings. The buildings were prisons, stores, stadiums, fortifications. But look at these guys. They're 15 doing this. And they're totally cool. This is totally easy, right? They loved it. They were so creative and so exciting. Are you ready for that generation? Are you ready for these little makers to be on your campus? All right, I'll take a couple of questions. This is a thing, by the way, by United Nations law. The end of every PowerPoint presentation has to have URLs. Right, you know that, yes. That's a joke. You can laugh. All right. Yeah. Questions, comments. Which trends did you most like? Do you need to go back to any slide?
how far are we from the paradigm that we don't work at all? The robots do everything, and you don't even need to think about these things.
It's interesting.
We get a basic salary, you know? But if you do things socially, then you get remunerated.
Hold on for a second. Do we need to record him with a mic, or should I just paraphrase it?
Yes.
Okay. So the question, who are you?
I'm Kanpaki. I come from Eastkins Malta Foundation.
Excellent. The question was a great 20th century question. How far away are we from the end of work, where humans don't have to do anything required for work, but we have some kind of basic income, and machines do all the labor?
I believe this was piloted in the U.S., I think one of the U.S., I'm not sure.
And in Canada. It is now being piloted in Finland. Where are the Finns here? Ah, a day without Finland is a sad day. This is a great question, and the great economist George Maynard Keynes predicted this in the 1930s.
Yes. So e-learning would definitely change there, because the paradigm totally changes altogether.
Yes, it does change. We could achieve this if we want to. The problem is we might not want to. So, for example, our economy is based on consumption. And so if we have machines making things, if humans make less of them, the question is, can the economy survive? So if we're not buying things, no.
But you have to realize that work is an integrated part of identification.
Yes.
For every human being. I think this doesn't work.
And therefore,
it's very important what we work and how we work, and work means social contacts. Work means progress. To come together means to feel each other. To get by feeling. Other impressions,
yes.
and you have to realize this point of view as well.
So that's why I said that then you can still work, but socially, you can come and do my garden if you want. You know? If you feel like working, the society will accept you to work, and it will remunerate you for that extra, of course. Yes, you do work.
Then we have to think about a new way of rewarding people.
Yeah.
Because work means to have to gain a social standard as well.
Yeah. Yeah. Maybe this trend is too far-fetched, but in any case, when I was in Brussels last time, this was being mentioned a number of times.
Yes.
Of course, we have driverless cars. And you start wondering next year what we will have next, you know, so.
Did you want to add to this?
Yeah, I don't think it's the case, actually, because internet is creating employment, in fact, and the big fork like Google and Facebook and eBay, they require a large number of customer care and humans, because the creativity is unique in humans. And the role of the teachers, particularly when very young age, in early ages, is crucial and remains so.
Yes. Oh, I completely agree.
Many are creating, because as well, the internet is becoming an arena and a space where for creativity, for human input, rather than.
Yes.
It's true that there's the effect that there's an agent, artificial intelligence, and all of them, all like eBay, there's an agent technology as well, but the human input remains crucial.
We often think about this problem in terms of what can machines do well versus what can humans do well. So one possible answer to your great question is we will have a divided world where humans do certain things and machines do other things. And creativity is often cited as one thing that humans do well, along with pattern recognition. But it may be that we instead end up only doing creative work, which would be an interesting response. Please, please.
First of all, wasn't it Facebook that just laid off quite a large number of people because they automated all their editing?
Yes.
So there we go. My point is this. We tend to talk in terms of exact changes that are going to happen, when in fact we know that there are so many deviant possibilities
yes.
to any one thing. Like, for example, you talked about those 15-year-olds creating, using 3D printers, et cetera, et cetera. Well, I have a 6-year-old cousin who uses a 3D printer. Absolutely tremendous. They are, they take to it like a duck to water. At this point in time, one thing we cannot forget, sometimes one of the things I say is that education happens while teachers are looking the other way. We often, youngsters are so wired, well, wireless, but you know what I mean.
Yeah, yeah.
They are so integrated within this immersion, if you like, within technology, that the learning processes are changing much faster than schools can keep up with.
Yes.
And they are actually getting the right education for whatever is going to be needed. Mm. Because it's right there, and they're absorbing it. What teachers need to do is actually understand that we need to become skill givers for those students in order for them to acquire more, if need be.
That's one thing. But the other thing we have to do is we have to take a look at that generation and the older generations and see when they're not getting these skills.
Right, and that's where we come in.
Were you in this morning for the keynote?
Unfortunately not, I had something else on.
I did want to repeat one thing that the keynoter mentioned, and forgive me if I mangle this, I don't know if she's here actually, was the problem of uneven gender uptake in ICT skills. So that we have, I think it was every country but one or two, it's the majority of males, boys and men, who go into a lot of the, that's not all of technology, but it's a lot of it, and that's a problem. So this is where schools come in. This is where universities come in.
But when it comes to gamification, for example, it's more the females that are taking up gamification than males.
And social media, for example.
One thing is I wouldn't say one thing compensates for the other, but the picture is a huge map.
Yes.
And it's impossible to just concentrate on just one area without it being affected, like weather, mapping, for it to not be affected by anything else that's happening around it. It's impossible to take it into isolation. We definitely need to try to understand the changes that are happening because of what's happening.
See, when I give presentations like this, I sometimes have to encourage an audience to get to the spot where you are right now. And sometimes people, but that's.
I hope that wasn't an insult, by the way.
No. This is because they have to get to this point of combining these, and then doing more with these trends because they do interact holistically and in ways that are very complex, literally mathematically complex. We had another hand up here. Yes, please. Actually, this is closer. Yeah. That's a better mic.
It's interesting the fact that you said that we don't know where we're going in a way because, let's face it, we are cyborgs. So we're not the humans that we used to be. And we will not be the humans right now in 20 years' time. We might be integrated with this AI more than we are already. I mean, right now I have an avatar in the sense of like I can travel through different dimensions and be in the other side of the country. And I can see through the stars. I'm having godly abilities, if you want. Maybe in a couple of years' time, the inverse will happen. Maybe there is a big EMF and there is no technology. And then I would need to become a scout. Maybe there is an asteroid coming and we'll have to go to space. Thing is that I think we need to be less patronizing with the next generation and knowing that they are going to be different than us and that their methods are going to be different than ours. So I think I really agree with the whole openness thing. So let them experiment, let us experiment, us learning from them learning from us. So mentoring, not just by telling them what to do, but guiding them, filling the thing. Listening to them, exactly, because they can teach us. My 2-year-old can teach me a lot of things. Malta.
Won't hug you, but of being less patronizing, this is a major, major issue in quite a few cultures. The earliest historical document I can find where old people complain about young people is a 7th century Byzantine history by Procopius, where have you seen, it's a wonderful document, but the old people complain about the kids and their haircuts because they're wearing their haircuts in imitation of the Huns. and they complain about this. But the patronizing bit is so huge right now. And the interesting problem, and I'll talk about this tomorrow, is demographically, so many of our societies in this room are aging rapidly, which seems to be going along with a lot of patronizing attitudes towards that shrinking, I was going to say lower class, but I meant young people. And we have to stop that. We have to listen hard to them. I mean, we're giving them a world that's not, we haven't done right by it in many ways. Now, we have to be very careful with that. Thank you for your comments. Please. This should be the last one.
Thank you. My name is Alessandro Brolpito. I am Italian. I work for an agency of the European Union. And I work in developing transition countries. And I think this is a really big opportunity. Of course, we are focusing on EU, EU member states, developed countries, American. But of course, we have to think also to these technologies and trends in transition in developing countries where the education system is really poor. And the access and the provision to knowledge, skills, it's very difficult. And of course, this open education concept could be great, and limiting migration issues and many other stuff. But my point is, because we want to speak about pedagogy, for me it's very important to highlight that the technology is very fast, we can't stop, and that is clear. But what's the point? And we have to really try to manage this process to some extent. There was a lot of discussion about the election in America and the role of the social media and whatever. To say that between us and you and all the people around here, there are algorithms that are built by people with specific objective. And this is even in education taking place if we are assuming to use the social media. So we have to be a bit critical users as well about this, because everybody are developing something with specific objective. And to me, it's very important that we mix together the neuroscience and the technology, because we need to know how our brain is working in the how I store things, how I can read, and why reading online or listening to a video. So technology is very fast, but we need also to understand how this is fitting in our neuroscience and the way our brain it works. And there is a lot of work, and I'm afraid in this case that we are a bit slower because it's more difficult.
Thank you very much. I'm nodding to everything you say because this is so important. I just wanted to one thing you pointed out. This is a recent data on where you mentioned our election. I didn't want to talk about it, but this is where Americans get their news. This is interesting. The majority get it from television, and then the blur between online, you know, news websites, social media, and then other media. So we're in this, I was mentioning before, the age gap is really, really strong, where we have this problem of, we have the old media and the new, and it's really divided along demographic lines. The neuroscience is fantastic, and unfortunately now it's still, in many ways, in early days. So the neuroscience of reading, we're still, there's contradictory information about it, but it's fascinating to see. Do you know Marianne Wolfe? She comparing digital reading to dyslexia, for example.
And for example, the OCD.
Yes.
Yes. There's no evidence that the performance of the students are really improving due mm-hmm. to mm-hmm. And to me, this was a very simplistic conclusion.
Yes.
We really not to reproduce the traditional pedagogy.
Exactly. Exactly.
But this is it's the dimension of the complexity mm-hmm. putting in the learning and teaching process that technology. This is part of the challenge.
Were you here this morning? So I was the one who asked the annoying question about less developed nations, among other things, and populations that are marginalized and how they could benefit. So that's a question that we should address another time.